greetings to all of you in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I hope you all are doing good, and this Sunday is going to be very powerful. We're going to continue with the series on anointing. But before we get into the word, we have beautiful worship led by Sister Adeline. So come, let's join her in worshiping the Lord our Creator.
There is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, 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 break every chain. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. Break every chain, 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 break every chain. I hear the chains falling. Oh, I hear the chains falling. Oh, I hear the chains falling. Oh, break, break, break every chain. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, Son of God and man. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, Son of God and man. He is high and lifted up. Oh, Jesus, we worship you, Jesus. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb. Oh, Jesus. Here I am, down on my knees. Like a rushing wind, Jesus breathes. hear your voice. Be hanging on every word. I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be than hearing your love, than hearing your love. No place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be hearing your love, hearing your love. That I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you. No place I would rather be. 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 Here in your love, here in your love. Oh, I wanna be here in your love, Jesus. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain. I want more of you, God. I want more of you. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you. Set a fire. Soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Yes, Lord. We want more and more and more of your presence, oh Father God. Are you hungry for Him today? Oh, we want more. Let's just welcome the way maker, the miracle worker, our promise keeper in our hearts, in our lives, and into our rooms as we worship Him, as we glorify His holy name. You are here, moving in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
You are.
worship Him.
That is who You are. Oh, miracle worker.
I hope all of you all rejoiced in worshiping the Lord. Yes, now it is time for our tithes and offerings. The details of our bank account are mentioned on the screen. Kindly make a note of it. God loves a cheerful giver. And even as you sow into the kingdom of God, He will open the floodgates of heaven and pour out His blessings that you will not be able to contain it. So let's give with a cheerful heart and the Lord will bless you abundantly. God bless you. The word of God. Prepare yourselves, and as you prepare, you will be able to receive the word in your spirit, which will transform your lives. Come, let's join together in welcoming our dear Pastor Cleophas David to share the word of God. God bless you.
Greetings to you in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Once again, it is a joy for me to bring the word of the Lord to you this morning. And I trust that you have been blessed with the series on the Elijah Mandate. And thank you for writing to us, and thank you for the feedback that you have shared and the testimonies that have been coming in of people experiencing deliverance and being activated even into the prophetic. So I'm really thankful to the Lord for His work and for bringing this understanding to our spirit in this season. So this morning we're going to be continuing to meditate on the Elijah Mandate. And this morning is very critical and crucial for each of them who are called into the prophetic ministry, because today we're going to be focusing on exposing the spirit of Jezebel. And the spirit of Jezebel is the demon that stands against the prophetic ministry. And we see in the scripture this pattern is very clear. And therefore, it is important for us to look to the word of God and study and understand the background of this spirit and how it works and how it manipulates and masquerades itself into the church and even into the nations. So we must be aware, as the scripture says in the book of Ephesians, that we must be aware of the wiles and the schemes of the devil, and we must put on the full armor of God. And therefore this morning I want you to put on the full armor of God. I want you to put on the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the sword of God's word, the shield of faith. Gird about your loins with the truth of God's word. Put on the gospel shoes of peace and enter into the battlefield fully armored, fully protected, and in understanding of how the enemy operates. Because you are called to be a soldier in the kingdom. You are called to be more than a conqueror. You're called to be an overcomer. And this morning's message is not about bringing fear into your hearts, but it is about exposing the spirit so that you will have the knowledge, the information and the understanding to fight this enemy, to overcome this enemy, and take your position and authority in the kingdom, so that this spirit will be weakened in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I believe that there is a mighty release of the presence of God this morning already. And even as we depend on the Holy Spirit to bring this word into our lives and to expose this spirit before us this morning, I believe that the Lord is opening your mind and your heart. And therefore, I don't want you to be distracted this morning. You know, sometimes we can be listening to the word, you know, cooking in the kitchen. We can be listening to the word, probably working and also doing something else. But I want you to put away everything, and I want you to put your heart, mind, and soul to study the word of God for the next 50 to 60 minutes. And as you give 1 hour to the Lord on the first day of this week, I believe the Lord is going to bless you, and the Lord is going to strengthen your spirit. You see, that is the key for the believer. If he can surrender, and if he can learn to hear the voice of God that is coming through the word of God, I believe that there will be a great healing and deliverance that will already take place in your mind. Hallelujah. So let the Holy Spirit refresh us this morning. Come on, open your mouths in your homes and say, Holy Spirit, refresh me this morning. Holy Spirit, empower me this morning. Holy Spirit, revive my life this morning through the precious word of the Lord. Hallelujah. Because I believe that there is such a glory when we begin to meditate on the word of God. There is a release of God's glory and power that touches us on the inside, and that activates some things in us, that breaks the powers of darkness and brings about a deliverance and a healing that will catapult us into a place where we will be totally protected, totally covered, and totally armored in the spirit to fight and overcome the powers of darkness. You see, the Bible says that Elijah brought fire down from heaven, and he killed the false prophets of the land. He caused an entire nation to repent before the presence of God. He turned their hearts back to the Lord, and he brought rain back into the land of Israel. And as he finished his assignment, as he finished what the Lord had commissioned him to do, he receives a threat from Jezebel. Now we see in 1 Kings chapter 19 verses 1, it says, Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Now we understand that Ahab was heavily under the influence of Jezebel, as we understood last week, that he saw fire come down from heaven. He saw an entire nation repent. Yet Ahab's heart did not turn to the Lord. Yet Ahab was hardened in his spirit because he had the influence of his wife Jezebel controlling him, manipulating him, and keeping him under her rule and authority, even though she did not occupy the office of the king. She influenced the king in his office, and that's how the Jezebel spirit works. And Ahab went and gave all the information of what happened on the top of Mount Carmel, which angered Jezebel. And Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying these words, "So may the gods do to me and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by this time tomorrow." So the threat was to kill Elijah. And the moment Elijah heard this threat, he ran for his life. The scripture says in the very next verse that then he was afraid and he arose and he ran for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. So the threat was so fearful that Elijah ran for his life. Yet this was the same Elijah who did all the great and mighty works in the previous chapter. Now, we must understand that the prophetic grace and anointing that was on Elijah was not just fighting Ahab and Jezebel, but it was fighting something that was released over generations in Israel. Now, we think that it was Ahab and Jezebel who brought Baal worship and the worship of, you know, all these gods in Israel. But way back in history, if you go 7 kings before Ahab, they ruled the son of David, King Solomon, who actually opened the gates for these gods to come into Israel, because Solomon was after all kinds of women. So the scripture is very clear, and we're going to look at 1 Kings chapter 11 to understand the history and the background of this spirit that was in Israel. Now, let's go to 1 Kings chapter 11 verses 1 to 6. 1 Kings chapter 11 verses 1 to 6. But King Solomon loved many strange women, together with the daughter of Pharaoh, the women of the Moabites, the Ammonites, the Edomites, the Zidonians, and the Hittites, of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, ye shall not go into them, neither shall they come in unto you. For surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clave unto these in love, and he had 700 wives who were princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. For it came to pass when Solomon was old that his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, so as was the heart of David his father. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Zidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. Why is this very important for us to understand? Now, if you read in 1 Kings chapter 18 verses 19, it says, now Elijah said, now therefore send and gather all Israel to me at Mount Carmel, and the 450 prophets of Baal, and the 400 prophets of Asherah or Ashtoreth, who eat at Jezebel's table. Now, the sacrifices and the offerings that were being offered to Baal and Ashtoreth in Israel by Ahab and Jezebel was what caused an entire nation to turn their hearts away from God. But their act of worship was not just their act, but way back in history, Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Zidonians. Now, we understand that Jezebel was also from the same place called the Zidonians. She was, who was Jezebel? Jezebel was the daughter of Ethbaal, the king of the Zidonians. So she was the princess. She was the daughter of Ethbaal, the king of the Zidonians. And she was the wife of Ahab. Now Ahab made an alliance with this king, and he married the daughter of this king, and he brought her into Israel. Now that's why we must understand that the door that was opened by Ahab for Jezebel to come into Israel was not just the door that Ahab opened, but he opened a door for which the gates were already opened. Now let me repeat that again. Now some of us think that it is Ahab who opened the door for Jezebel to come into Israel by marrying her. no doubt about it. But he opened the door because the gates were already opened by Solomon. That's why we must understand very clearly that there are some spirits that you are fighting in this season and in this hour, not because you opened the door, not because you opened the door, but the gates have already been opened or had already been opened by somebody else before you. And therefore, it is important to understand that the level of warfare that you are fighting in this hour is not because of anything else, but because of certain gates that were open for the enemy to come in and go into your environment. So you must identify the gates that have been opened. You see, sometimes we think that the enemy comes in through doors. The enemy does not just come through the doors, but the enemy comes through the gates. Jesus said, "Upon this rock will I build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." So, which means there are spiritual gates that are over cities, over nations, over communities, which can be opened because of a certain form of worship. When Solomon fell in love with all these strange women, the Bible calls them strange women. They're not ordinary women, but they were strange women. They were strange in nature. They came seeking for the wisdom of Solomon, but they knew the weakness of Solomon. And they came in seeking for wisdom, and they ended up becoming his wives. And the scripture is clear here in 1 Kings 11 that he loved many strange women together with the daughter of Pharaoh. The women of the Moabites, the Ammonites, the Edomites, the Zidonians, and the Hittites. So from all the groups that God forbid, the Lord God forbid the people of Israel to marry, or the men of Israel to marry, Solomon fell in love with all those women. And he had 700 wives. And it was his wives who turned his heart away from the Lord. Now you may wonder, how did Solomon manage 700 wives? He had wisdom. The Bible says the Lord gave Solomon wisdom. So imagine, he used up all of his wisdom managing these 700 wives. Yet he wrote Proverbs and he wrote many songs, but he was after these women, and these women became his wives, and he needed, or he had wisdom to deal. Some of us are, you know, hoping and praying that God would give us wisdom to deal with one wife. But here was Solomon with his wisdom handling 700 wives and 300 concubines. All in all, 1,000 women in his palace. And he had the wisdom to keep 1,000 women. Can you believe that? But as he kept them in his palace and in his environment, they turned his heart away from the Lord. So you can have all the wisdom, and yet your heart may not be in the right place. Yet your heart can be turned away, because the women that Solomon married, they started to influence his worship. You see, when they turned his heart away from the Lord, it meant that they influenced his worship. And when spirits try to influence your worship lifestyle, then you know that they are the problem in your life. You know that those are the spirits, those are the people that you need to disconnect from. Any person, any woman, any man, any demon that comes against the worship of the true living God does not deserve a place in your life. And Jesus said that very clearly. He said that you shall worship the Lord and your Lord God alone. And that was the beauty about David. David sinned He murdered, but he never compromised on his worship. He would be immediately on his knees worshiping the Lord. He would go on his face, repent, and turn his heart back to the Lord. He was a man after God's own heart. He did not go after women outside of Israel. He did not bring all kinds of other gods into Israel. He did not have high places in Israel where worship was offered to other gods, because David's heart was very pure when it came to worshiping the Lord. He was sold out to bringing the ark back into Israel. He danced before the ark. He restored worship into Israel. He built a tabernacle of worship unto the Lord. And that was the beauty about David. But yet Solomon did not walk in the ways of his father, and he had all the wisdom that was given to him. He built the temple for God to come and dwell, and he offered sacrifices, and he did all these things, but yet his heart turned away from the Lord to an extent where now the same man who built a temple for the Lord is now building altars for these gods. For the fact that he went after a certain god that we see, which is the Ashtoreth, which was the goddess of the Zidonians, from the same group where Jezebel came from. So Solomon had opened the gates for these principalities to come into Israel. And when he allowed that to happen, the nation was divided. The kingdom was divided after his death. The nation of Israel became northern Israel and southern Israel. And there were two kings ruling, one the northern and one the southern. And it brought about a division in the land of Israel. So you can understand what happens when we disallow certain things to creep in because of our lust and our desire for those things. Your lust and your desire for certain things can open the gates of hell against your life. Yet today the Lord is reminding you that you can have all the wisdom, you can have all the anointing, you can have all the giftings, but if you desire and lust for things that is demonic in nature, that takes away your pleasure of worshiping the Lord, it will replace itself in your life. That's what happened to Solomon at the end of his life. He ended up building up these altars to please his wives. He was no longer in a place where he was pleasing God, but he was pleasing the women that he had married. Now, we must understand that God is exposing this so that you understand certain things. There are certain gates that are opened against your destiny. Maybe because of your fleshly desires. Maybe because of your sinful passions. And you need to be in a place where you can identify that and put on the full armor of God and stand against the wiles and the schemes of the enemy. And that's why the prophetic anointing is the key to overcome these things. Now, we must understand that the Jezebel who married Ahab and who was the wife of Ahab, there were certain traits that we can observe in this spirit of Jezebel. As we discussed earlier, Jezebel was the daughter of Ethbaal, the king of the Zidonians. And she was the wife of Ahab. And as she married Ahab, she also brought in the worship of these gods into Israel, just like what happened to Solomon. When Solomon married and he made an alliance through his marriage, they brought in the worship of all these gods into Israel. So Ahab did a similar thing. And when he did a similar thing, he became one of the most wicked kings in Israel because he had raised the bar or the level of worship to these gods to a greater extent, because Jezebel and Ahab infiltrated the land. They had even occupied the high places in Israel. They even built altars on Mount Carmel for the worship of Baal and Ashtoreth. To the fact that the entire nation was infiltrated with this form of worship. Now, let's try to understand how this spirit of Jezebel works. Number one, the spirit of Jezebel wants to influence or indirectly occupy the office of the king. Now, we see very clearly that though Ahab was the king, he was heavily under the influence of Jezebel, and Jezebel actually influenced all his decisions, influenced his worship, influenced his laws, influenced his policies, influenced everything. So it was indirectly trying to attack or control the office of the king. Now, that is something that we have not discussed before, because we normally don't talk about Jezebel controlling kings. We talk about Jezebel being a hindrance to the prophets or trying to control the prophetic. But the Jezebel is also after the kings. And who are the kings in the modern church today? The scripture says in Revelations 1:6 that you and I are called to be kings and priests unto the Lord. So when we are called to be kings and priests unto the Lord, the enemy wants to attack our kingly authority. And it is the spirit of Jezebel that will try to control the office and the authority of the king that has been given to us. You and I are kings. He is the king of kings, the Bible says. So that's why we must be aware of this spirit. Now, the spirit of Jezebel looks for wealth, influence, and power to occupy and move through. The spirit of Jezebel what? Looks for wealth. Where is the wealth? The wealth is in the king's courts. The wealth is in the hands of the king. So it looks for wealth. It looks for influence. It looks for power. So as we grow in our influence, as we grow in our anointing and grace, as we grow even in our wealth, we must be aware of this spirit that will try to dominate and control our office. That's why it's very important to stay under the mighty hand of God, no matter how successful and influential you become in the kingdom of God. Now, in the case of Ahab, we see that he had access to the king as his wife. It controlled the worship, the environment, the atmosphere of an entire nation. Number four, it controlled to an extent where it weakened the authority of a king, and he was unable to make any decisions. He was unable to see things in God's perspective. Now, that is how the spirit of Jezebel works. It will masquerade itself to an extent where it will show itself as somebody who wants to partner with you, somebody who wants to help you in your destiny, but yet will control you in the way you do what God has called you to do. And that's where you must identify that there is a Jezebelic influence in that person. Now, sometimes we make the mistake of just calling everything a Jezebelic spirit when we see somebody controlling and manipulating. Not everything that controls and manipulates has a Jezebelic influence. As I said, that Jezebel tries to control the office and the authority of the king. It looks for wealth, influence, and power. Now, there are some people who are by nature very controlling and domineering. we cannot just term them as somebody who are under the influence of the Jezebelic spirit. We must be careful not to label people, because that could be an attitude or behavior that needs to be corrected in them. Amen. Number five, it has access to the pen of the king. We see in 1 Kings chapter 21 that Ahab desired the vineyard of Naboth in the valley of Jezreel. And when Naboth refused to give him the land, and he said, "The Lord forbid that I give you the inheritance of my fathers," Ahab went home sulking, and he was disappointed, and he was discouraged, and he did not eat any food. And Jezebel came and asked him, "Why are you so sad?" And Ahab said that Naboth refused to give me his vineyard. And Jezebel said, "Aren't you the king of Israel?" And then she said these words. She said, "I will give you the vineyard of Naboth." And when she said that, she wrote letters with the pen of the king in the name of the king and sent it to the elders in the place where Naboth was. And she had Naboth stoned to death because she passed an allegation against him saying that he cursed God and the king, and therefore he was stoned. And that vineyard was then taken from Naboth and given to Ahab, just as Jezebel had told Ahab. So Jezebel has access to the king and can write letters in his name. So we can understand, when there are certain letters, there are certain accusations that come to you, that come falsely against you, we know the kind of spirit that is working behind this. It devises strategies to take over the inheritance of your fathers. Oh my God. Now, Jezebel devised a strategy to take over Naboth's vineyard, and not only Naboth's vineyard, but the inheritance of his fathers. So identify those spirits that are trying to enter your homes, that are trying to enter into your families, to take over the inheritance of your fathers, to take over properties, to take over and start controlling, because that is the nature of the spirit of Jezebel. It looks for wealth, it finds influence, and then it uses that influence to its advantage. And as Ahab gave into Jezebel, he began to grow more weaker and weaker. And you will see that your authority will be weakened over a period of time as you stay under the influence of this Jezebelic spirit. Your authority will be weakened. You will not be functioning in your God-given authority. You will be functioning under the influence of this Jezebelic demon. So therefore, the prophetic anointing that was on Elijah, now you can understand, was not just fighting Ahab and Jezebel, but it was fighting the spirits and the gods that had entered into Israel from the time of Solomon till Ahab. And we see that throughout the book of 1 Kings, that the kings who were part of the northern part of Judah, they all fell into sin. So that is the work of the spirit, that it would cause the king to sin against the Lord. It would cause the king's heart to turn away from the Lord. Because if it can attack the heart of the king, and if it can have access to the heart of the king, it can stop the worship from coming into a nation and into the churches. And that's why it's important to pray for the kings and the leaders of your nation. Because this Jezebelic spirit operates at a national level, operates even in the realm of the church. We will see that a little later in the context of the New Testament as to how this spirit of Jezebel works. But we see the trait of the spirit in the Old Testament, which can still be seen even today. This Jezebelic spirit can operate at a national level because it wants to control nations. It wants to control kings. It wants to control authorities. It wants to control offices. It wants to control policy making. It wants to control decisions, powers, authorities. And we can see the traits of this spirit in certain governments even today in the nation, in the world. Hallelujah. I want you to just take a minute and just begin to pray in the spirit right now. Even as we are meditating on this spirit of Jezebel, I believe as the modern church, we must understand how to discern the spirit of Jezebel in our time. Because the more we learn to understand and discern how this spirit works, we must learn to overcome and take our authority in this spirit realm. Amen. Now, Jezebel was under the influence of Baal and Ashtoreth, the same god that Solomon had built altars to at the end of his life. And these gods had replaced the worship of the God of Israel in the land. So when Elijah heard this threat, some may wonder, why would Elijah run from Jezebel? He could have called Jezebel to Mount Carmel again and said, let's have another showdown. But he didn't. He ran because he still did not have a word from God to overcome this spirit. He had a word from the Lord to bring famine and rain, but he did not have a word to overcome this Jezebelic authority in Israel, and therefore he ran. And so it is very evident that the prophet Elijah was so dependent on the word from the Lord. Therefore he ran in fear. And sometimes we can complain and say, oh, Elijah was a weak man and all of that. But Elijah knew that he did not have a word yet to fight this. He did not have a word yet to overcome this. He could have gone into the presence of God and prayed, but he ran in fear because he was still human. And when he ran for fear, the fear that the enemy sent through the messenger opened up Elijah's heart into the realm of fear and brought discouragement to his soul. What happened? In verse number 4 of 1 Kings 19, it says, but he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. So one word from this Jezebel spirit sent Elijah into the wilderness in fear. It drove him to dry places and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he asked that he might die. Oh my God. Now, Elijah, in response to this word, when he ran in fear, he went into the wilderness. And the second thing that he did was, he asked that he may die, which meant that he had already allowed discouragement to affect his heart. Oh my God. He had allowed fear to control him. Now you see, Jezebel was not in person, but she sent a message. That message had fear, discouragement written all over it. And Elijah received this message and allowed this message to affect his heart. Some of you are not fighting people, but you're fighting the words that people have spoken over you. You may not be in the physical fighting that individual or seeing that individual, but you're fighting the very words that this individual has spoken over you. And these words are tormenting you. These words are discouraging you. These words have kept you in fear. These words have brought you under the juniper tree and you're sitting and wondering, I am no better than my fathers. Now you see, Elijah had come to a state all of a sudden where he's saying that I am no better than my fathers. So he started comparing himself to his natural fathers. He said, I'm no better than my fathers. Take my life, God. And what was he saying? And he asked that he might die, saying, it is enough now, Lord, take away my life, for I am no better than my fathers. And he lay down and slept under a broom tree or a juniper tree. So he ran far away from his assignment in Israel. And he was discouraged. And he was asking the Lord to take away his life. One word. So that's why we must understand that the Jezebelic spirit operates through messages of fear, control, and dominance. Now, in the letters to the seven churches Jesus gave through John, the Lord exposed three spirits in his message to the seven churches. One was the false teaching of Balaam, whose ultimate aim was to seduce the people through Balak. The second was the heresy and the false teaching of the Nicolaitans, which was to dominate the people. The third was the woman Jezebel, who called herself a prophetess and teaching and seducing the servants to practice sexual immorality and to eat food sacrificed to idols. So to the two churches, one is to Pergamum and the next was to Thyatira, in the message to these two churches, the Lord exposed these three spirits: the spirit of Balaam, the spirit of the Nicolaitans, and the Jezebel. Now, why is it important for us to know this? In the battle against our prophetic destiny comes from these three spirits. The enemy can bring certain kinds of false teaching to pollute the prophetic through the teachings of Balaam. Can bring certain teachings that can cause the true prophets to fall into heresy. Now, in the book of Revelation chapter 2 verses 20, it says that Jezebel called herself a prophetess. Oh my God, that's the most dangerous thing right there. Very clear, the Lord exposed the spirit by saying that this Jezebel calls herself a prophetess. So how does the modern day church discern the spirit of Jezebel? When you see people calling themselves a prophet and a prophetess without being ordained by the church, without being commissioned by the church, they call themselves a prophetess, they call themselves a prophet, then that's something for you to discern and take note of. Now, when you discern, it does not mean that you need to go around judging them. It is up to the Lord to judge them, but it is up to you to discern and take guard and put on the full armor of God to take your position. I'm going to teach you how to overcome this spirit of Jezebel in a while. But it is important that you understand how in the new covenant that the spirit of Jezebel in the old covenant or in the Old Testament controlled the office of the king. It desecrated the office of the king. It got access in the heart of the kings. Now, that trait continues even today. We see that in during the time of John the Baptist, King Herod's wife asked for the head of John the Baptist. And John the Baptist had the spirit of Elijah in him. And we can see a clear trait of the Jezebelic, because King Herod's wife asked for the head of Jezebel through the daughter and had John the Baptist's head cut off. In the new covenant, there is something that the Lord is showing us here, that she calls herself a prophetess and is teaching. So the second thing is, she's teaching and seducing my servants. Oh, now that is the part that you need to see. She's seducing my servants to what? To practice sexual immorality and to eat food sacrificed to idols. Now you may say, how does this all connect to the time that we're living in? You know, I don't eat food sacrificed to idols. Or, but what you must understand is this, that this Jezebelic influence will cause you to listen to a certain teaching that may sound like it is from God, but the fruit of this teaching will lead you into sin and sexual immorality. Sexual sins in your life will be on the rise when you have the Jezebelic influence in your life. And that's why you will see so many ministers of God or even children of God falling into adultery, falling into immorality. What is sexual immorality? Sexual immorality is any form of sexual relation outside the context of marriage. Falling into sins like pornography, falling into sexual sins outside your marriage, dangerous against you and your destiny. So you must be careful. So the enemy is not going to come as the enemy. He can masquerade himself as a prophet and a prophetess and come to teach and seduce you. So you must discern it by the kind of fruit that you're bearing. If you've lost holiness in your life, if you've lost reverence for God, then it is a sign that the Jezebelic influence is at work in your life. And it says very clearly that it seduces the servants of God. So again, it is not looking at just ordinary believers. It is operating at a certain level. It is attacking the servants of God. So the servants of God must walk in a higher level of purity and a higher level of consecration in order to protect themselves against the spirit of Jezebel. So it seduces the servants of God. It attacked Elijah. You see, it couldn't seduce Elijah, but it attacked Elijah. And when it attacked Elijah, Elijah came to a point where his authority was so weakened that he said, "Lord, take my life." And he went and hid in a cave and he was depressed. And he was in a cave. And the Lord came and his voice came into the cave saying, "Elijah, what doest thou here?" And the voice of the Lord brought Elijah out of the cave, made him stand on the mountain. And then the voice of the Lord came to him again. And then the Lord commissioned Elijah to finish his assignment by anointing 3 people in his capacity. So there were 3 people who replaced Elijah. Jehu was commissioned to defeat Jezebel. Elisha the prophet was anointed to be the prophet in his room. And then the king of Syria. So the three of them. Now you must understand that it was Jehu who killed Jezebel. Jehu was anointed as the king to overcome Jezebel or destroy Jezebel. Because the Jezebelic controlled the office of the king, God appointed another king in the same office and authority to destroy Jezebel. So how do you overcome the spirit of Jezebel. You take your authority in the office of the king. Hallelujah. You take your authority as a believer. You take your authority as a son and daughter of the Lord. You take your authority because you and I are called to be kings and priests unto the Lord. So when you take your authority and you function from your authority, you weaken the spirit. You see, sometimes you don't need to always kill demons. You need to walk in authority, because your walking in authority weakens these spirits. The only way the church can weaken the Jezebel is by functioning in the prophetic and the kingly authority that has been given to her. Amen. You must take up your position in authority and not let this spirit control the God-given authority that is in your life. I don't know, as I'm sharing this word, I sense there are some people who are watching who have been attacked by the spirit of Jezebel unknowingly or knowingly, and you feel your authority has been weakened somehow. You are called, you are anointed, you are gifted to walk in a certain level of authority and in your office, but yet you feel weakened. You're not able to function in your full potential because there is an influence of the Jezebelic. And I pray this morning, the Lord will open your eyes so that you will be in a place to overcome the spirit. You will be in a place to walk in authority and trample against the spirit. Because as I'm sharing this word, the Lord is strengthening your authority. He's opening your eyes. He's opening your eyes. He's opening your eyes. Don't let the spirit of Jezebel control the worship. Don't let the spirit of Jezebel control what you preach and teach in the church. Don't let the spirit of Jezebel control your decision making. Because it wants to oversee the administration. It wants to oversee things in the church. But you must be in a position to take authority. Every alliance that you have made, knowingly or unknowingly, with the Jezebelic is being broken in the mighty name of Jesus. Prophet of the Lord, kings of the Lord, arise this morning, says the Spirit of the Lord. I have given you the authority through the finished work of Jesus to overcome these spirits, to overcome these influences in your life. You may be praying for a loved one who is under this Jezebelic influence. May God give you the authority. You see, one of the ways that we can overcome this spirit is by allowing the Holy Spirit to teach us how this spirit functions. As you listen to this teaching, even again later this week, you will sense a supernatural deliverance coming to you. If you are down, discouraged, if you are down in the pits this morning, if you're down and you're feeling that my life is over, I'm done and dusted like Elijah, you're saying, oh Lord, take away my life, I am no good. You know the influence of the Jezebel is at work. So you must take your authority and say, no, I am going to rise up. I am going to finish my assignment on this earth. I am going to finish the course that God has commissioned for me on this earth. I will finish my journey on a high note. I am not giving this Jezebel any place in my life. I'm going to rise up. And I'm going to take authority in the name of the Lord. See, the Lord anointed Jehu to destroy Jezebel in the natural. But destroying Jezebel in the natural was a way of God reminding the people of Israel that Jezebel and Ahab were wicked rulers over the nation. and they had to pray and repent and turn their hearts back to God. Elijah prophesied after Jezebel and Ahab took the vineyard of Naboth. Elijah came and prophesied to Ahab, saying that the Lord will destroy you and burn you up, and dogs will eat and lick the blood of Jezebel fallen on the street. And it happened exactly that way when Jehu destroyed Jezebel. So I pray that you will recognize the authority the Lord has given you this morning. The battle belongs to the Lord, but you need to rise up in authority this morning. You need to rise up in authority in such a way that this influence is weakened in your life completely. This control, this manipulation, this spirit that even affects the way you worship God is weakened this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. And you have the grace of God this morning to put on the full armor of God. Prophet of the Lord, arise this morning. Children of the Lord, arise this morning and ask the Holy Spirit to fill you afresh. I'm going to pray with you, and I'm going to pray and ask the Lord to fill you afresh with His grace. Spirit of the living God, I pray that there will be a fresh awakening in the hearts and minds of your children. If in your homes, if you're watching in your homes, open your mouth and begin to pray in the spirit. Remona satalakaterenemekabaha. Every depression, every anxiety, every fear that this Jezebelic influence has brought in your life, may it end today in Jesus' mighty name. May you hear this as a word from the Lord. Shake the dust off your feet. Arise, for the journey ahead is more greater. The journey ahead is more greater, says the Lord. There is a great journey ahead of you, man and woman of God. Arise, 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 arise. Don't let this demon, this spirit, influence your destiny anymore. Today is the end of it. Arise and shine. Walk into your assignments. Walk into your destiny. Walk into your God-given calling. Some of you have not realized that this spirit has stopped you from functioning unknowingly. You think that it is your discouragement, but no, the enemy has released discouragement after discouragement into somebody's spirit. I see this clearly. Discouragement after discouragement, fear after fear, to a point where it's weakened your authority. But God says, arise, my son and daughter. Don't let this spirit weaken your authority. Because the level of authority you have in your spirit is enough to overcome and trample these demons. You have the grace to prophesy and declare the word of the Lord to the peoples, to the nations of the earth. Arise this morning. Arise this morning. Let there be a fresh anointing that is released upon you this morning. A fresh grace is coming upon you this morning. Arise and shine, for your time has come, says the Lord. You will not end your life in fear and discouragement, but you will arise and you will shine for the Lord, says the Spirit of the Lord. Arise, for Christ Jesus has overcome the works of darkness. The ruler of the world has nothing in Jesus. And when this Jesus is in you, the enemy has nothing in you. Whatever doors or gates that have been opened, may it be shut this morning in the mighty name of Jesus through the word of God. I shut every gate, I shut every door this morning in the name of Jesus. May you be delivered and may you be set free. And may you rejoice, for victory belongs to us. Hallelujah. God bless you and have a wonderful, wonderful Sunday. And I look forward to meeting you again next Sunday. And join us for the revival season. We have some great things happening this week as well. And I want you to be rejoicing, and I want you to be in a place where you say that God is with me and I will not fear, I will not be discouraged, I will not give up in this time because the Lord is on my side. Hallelujah. Arise and shine. God bless you. Have a wonderful, wonderful week, and see you soon again. Bye-bye.